So we need a faster test for primes. And what we're going to use is a probabilistic test. And that means if some number x passes the test, the probability that x is composite is less than some value. And we're going to use probabilities like 2 to the negative 128. This is certainly low enough for most uses in cryptography. One way to think about that is if the key size is 128 bits, we already have that probability that someone would randomly guess that key correctly. So the main basis of probabilistic primality tests is properties of prime numbers. One useful theorem about prime numbers is Fermat's little theorem, which states that if p is prime, if we select some number a between 1 and p and raise a to the p minus 1 power modulo p, the result must always be 1. So maybe we could try lots of a's, and if this equation always holds that a to the p minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod p, well, that would mean that p is probably prime. So the problem is that there are some composite numbers that are known as Carmichael numbers, where this test also holds for most a values. Indeed, it holds for all of the a values that are relatively prime with p. So unless we try all the a numbers between 1 and p, there's a high probability that this will always hold. If we need to try them all, well, this test isn't fast enough. It's still going to be exponential in the size of p. The good news is there's a faster test, which is known as the Rabin-Miller test. Sometimes it's known as the Miller-Rabin test. It was discovered independently by both Miller and Rabin. The main idea was originally proposed by Gary Miller in 1976. He provided a deterministic test based on the assumption that the Riemann hypothesis was true. Michael Rabin, who won the Turing Award in 1976, probably did some of his more important work after winning the Turing Award, which is quite unusual, proposed this in 1980, and that's the one that we'll talk about. So here's how this works, and I'm not going to cover the mathematics behind it, but just enough to be able to implement the test. So we're going to start with our guess n, which must be odd. Obviously, if it's even, it's not prime. And because it's odd, that means we can write it as a multiple of 2 plus 1. So that means we can break n into 2 to some power t times s plus 1. Next, we're going to choose some random a value in this range from 1 to n minus 1. If n is prime, we know that either a to the s is equal to 1 mod n, or we know that a to the s times 2 to the j is equal to n minus 1 mod n for some j, and the j values are in the range from 0 to t minus 1, which is the power here. And that's the big advantage, that we only need to try a small number of values. If we don't find any value that satisfies this, we know it's composite. So the important property that this test has that's different from the Fermat test is that the probability that a composite number passes is always less than some constant. In this case, it's less than 1/4. There are no bad composite numbers like the Carmichael numbers. If we choose a randomly for any composite number, the probability that the test passes is less than 1/4.